give a comprehensive answer.
Okay, so I think we are live now. Just let me know if you are visible or if it's live. It is. I cannot see on my FB page. Acha. So Pranav says it's live. So I think I'll start. All right. Should I wait for more viewers, Pranav? Okay, so you just let me know when I should start.
So he knows how many viewers are there.
Yeah, he can see. But
on Zoom, only three of us are there. Huh?
Yes. So on Facebook, we can check how many viewers are there.
Achha.
I cannot see it. I don't know why.
Correct. I also.
We are live. Okay, sorry. We are live actually. I can start. Just give me a heads up. I'll go.
Your head is stuck. Okay. Now it's okay. Let's go. A little behind you.
This is okay. Thanks.
Mine is okay, no? Positioning?
Yes, yes. Perfect.
Voila. 4 months now, we have become all experienced.
Right.
Last week of March, it all started. With all trial and error, one has picked up. Yes.
So, yeah, I'll start.
Okay.
So yeah, hello, guys. Thank you, everyone, for joining us today. So, we are discussing on decoding the changes in labor law and its impact on menstruators with Dr. Vibhuti Patel. So she is a PhD in economics. She was awarded a visiting fellowship to the London School of Economics and Political Science in 1992-93. Also, she is a good combination of feminist economist academician and also former professor at the Advanced Center for Women's Studies at Tata Institute of Social Sciences. So for those of you wondering the usage of term menstruator, the term is used to include people that don't particularly have female body. Also, not everyone who menstruates is a woman, and not every woman menstruates. So that is the reason we are using the term menstruator. Over to you, ma'am. If you want to give an introduction, or should I move on to my first question? Okay. Yeah. So my first question to you is, can you tell us the overall contribution of women workforce to Indian economy?
Women have made both paid and unpaid work contribution to the national economy. So whether when it comes to the market economy, women's part of the statistics show that only 23% of women are part of the workforce. And historically also we have seen that during the colonial times, around 30-35%, one third of the women in the able-bodied women, or the way we define labor force in the age group of 15 to 59, were in the either working in the factory or plantation or agriculture or offices. To 1971, we had the lowest work participation rate of 11%. And the way they were called main workers. Who are the main workers? The women who are working for 8 hours a day for continuously doing same type of work in 186 days, they are considered as main workers. So there is a basically a conceptual bias also, because women do multitasking. And even there is a seasonality in women's work. If they are those who are doing in the monsoon, they are doing, say, agricultural work. In the other season, or in a dry season, or in this thing, they would be doing winnowing or husking or animal husbandry. So, but for the first time, it was in 1971 that the whole question about the data system, the kind of statistics and indicators we have, which grossly underestimate women's contribution. Even in economics, the first thing we are taught is that if a man marries his wife, national income will reduce. Why? Because as a wife, man marries his cook, national income will reduce. Why? Because as a cook, she was getting wages, and a wife doing the same work, she would not be getting wages. That means we are dividing the economy into the paid and unpaid. And large majority of women are the unpaid family workers, or they work if there is a household. Like in a country like India, you have a handicraft in whole of the rural sector, or in agriculture, or even if you go in the basti, home-based work that women are doing, all this is not even counted. So, and other thing of not only cooking, cleaning and carrying, but collection of fuel, collection of water, collection of firewood, then looking after animals, doing kitchen gardening, all these kind of activities, they augment family resources. If women did not bring water, you'd have to buy water. If they did not bring grass, you would have to purchase grass. If they did not look after the animals, you would have to get milk and meat from outside. Okay, so this kind of work is not considered as a work. So unpaid work is very, very important component of women's contribution to the national economy. And second one is a paid work. So those who are working, we have an industrial category, 7 industrial categories. You see large number of women are in the service oriented activity, which is also an extension of the housework which they do, because women serve. So, okay, so that plantation has a very big chunk, around 50%, 51% of women are in the plantation economy. Manufacturing sector, earlier we had a lot of contribution of women. But what we saw that after 1980, there has been a massive informalization of women. So though women do important work, there is a weeding out of married women with children from the workforce. And then there was an induction of a young unmarried girls in the age group of 15 to 18, okay, who are school dropouts, who are moderately educated, into the new industries such as electronics, electrical, nanotechnology, and all this. So we are seeing the variety, the contours of women's participation in the workforce and contribution have changed. I would like to hear quote, like in 1974, when the Towards Equality Report was presented in the parliament, for the first time in the post-independence period, there was a discussion about women's status in the economy, and that also came as a result of the UN directive, and 165 countries submitted the report. India also submitted, and 3 startling features which of this report, and that whole report is on the Google, on the net, and you can also get the translations of this report in several Indian languages. So this report, they said that there was a continuous declining work participation of women in the post-independence period. Whether it was a green revolution or white revolution or blue revolution or agricultural mechanization or tractorization or high yielding variety, all these new forces in the economy, in the agrarian economy and in the urban economy also, in the industrial sector also, every time the automation, mechanization, rationalization took place, women's jobs were axed. So by 71, we reached a stage where we saw that women who were getting incomes or salary or wages, their proportion had reduced. So Towards Equality Report invited the attention, and it also said that it also reflects on women's status. There are so many indicators when women don't, economic independence is a minimum necessary condition for a dignified life. And when the moment you women are seen as a, they don't earn, they are seen as a burden. And we also saw that when work participation was declining, sex selective abortions and elimination of curse, that also became a major problem. Dowry murders became a problem. Women being treated as a easily disposable thing, that also increased. And it was in this context that Amrita Pritam wrote a beautiful verse, and that was highly popular in the women's studies and women's movement during the 70s. Ko ke andhere se kabr ki shanti tak, from the darkness of womb to the silence of grave. And what she says about work is extremely important. Ghar mein kaam karne wali औरत के पति से पूछा जाए कि आपकी बीबी क्या करती है, जवाब मिलता है मेरी बीबी काम नहीं करती, नहीं करती। एंड देन अमृता प्रीतम आस्क्ड, तो फिर कौन इस दुनिया चलाने अपनी कोख से किसानों और मजदूरों को पैदा करता है, कौन खाना पकाता, कपड़े धोता, सफाई करता है, कौन पानी लाता, ईंधन लाता, बीमारों को देखता है, वो किसकी मेहनत, जिसकी बदौलत मर्दों को वक्त मिल जाता है अपने दोस्तों के साथ शराब, हुक्का, बीड़ी, सिगरेट पीने का, किसकी मेहनत से मर्दों को रोज ताकत मिलती है काम पर जाने की, खाना खाने की या मजदूरी की, वो कौन है जो मेहनत करता बिना पैसे या कम पैसे, जिसके काम मेहनत की कोई कदर नहीं। एंड द सेम ट्रेंड इज कंटिन्यूइंग इवन इन 2020 वेर यू हैव, whether it is in farm sector, majority of women are in the agrarian sector. We know women in a farm sector, in agriculture sector, either as a farmer's wife or farmer's widow. Women don't have a status of farmer. When you are not recognized as a status, as a worker, all the social security and social protection about the workers you don't get. Same thing happens in the jodi system, whether you must be seeing in every suburb women are asking for work at the railway station or in this, but what the employer would say, we want a jodi, man and woman. Yeah, so construction industry has a jodi system, sugarcane field, about which Mimamsa told you, there also you have a jodi system. Wherever you have this jodi system, woman is faceless. She doesn't have any independent right. Wages are given to the men. And even in the scheme workers, like all the schemes, we have so many anti-poverty programs, centrally sponsored schemes, central schemes, this everywhere. A contractor also with the same patriarchal bias doesn't see women. They see women as a supplementary earner or subsidiary earner. This is the problem. United Nations, when it computed, its statistical wing of United Nations computed the contribution of women in the developing countries like India. They said that women constitute 1/2 of world's population. They do 2/3 of world's work. In agrarian sector, 65% of the agricultural tasks are done by women. We are saying that future of agriculture is with women. There is a feminization of agriculture, but when it comes to women's rights or money wages, they are not getting it. What women get in return for such a paid and unpaid work, at 2/3 of the world's work, is 1/10 of world's income, and women own or cut only 1% of world's wealth or a property. So here is the pyramid in which you see that women workers are in the bottom of the pyramid. They do the most backbreaking, monotonous, dead-end work for a very, very long hours without any rest or recreation or taking any break. There are n number of studies. In 1975, ICSSR gave a mandate to newly formed women's studies centers within the university system and ICSSR centers to examine the labor processes and labor relations of women in the workforce. And all the studies proved that women were contributing a lot. Women's income, 65% of women's income directly goes for the basic livelihood needs of the family. Okay, whether it's a health needs, education needs, and main thing is the food. Okay, so that is the strategic role of women in the economy. But question is that of a recognition of women's work, visibility of women's work, and the adequate reward for the work which women are doing, both as unpaid workers and paid workers.
I think it's high time the world recognizes the contribution of women. I think this lockdown has shown and to some extent, like even if the men who go to work got a break, not the women, it's not the same for the
women. And the UN study shows of 182 countries rapid need assessment study from March 25th to the present, it shows that men are doing only two tasks, playing with the children and shopping. Rest of the work of, first of all, women have to look after themselves because they can't afford to get sick. If they get sick, who will look after others? Adult care, elderly care, child care, and all the domestic chores. And when all the family members are in the house, their demands are also more. You are not getting any ready to eat or a semi-processed food. Each and everything has to be cooked in the house. And you have to make 4 meals. It is not 2 meals, dinner and lunch. You have to make morning snacks and people are at home. So in the evening, they have snacks also they need. So the stress level of women have also gone out. The demands of the family have also gone up. And they are the ones who have to supervise even those who can afford to have internet facility. They have to supervise their children's online classes. So it has been tough for women.
So moving forward, since we are discussing women or menstruators who work, can we draw a comparison of women workers in formal and informal sector?
So we in India, if we go by the ILO data, only 6% of women are in the formal sector. So those who are in formal sector, who are formal sector, we had a 44 labor laws earlier. If I say the Workmen's Compensation Act 1923, the Trade Union Act 1926, Payment of Wages Act 1936, Industrial Employment Act, Industrial Dispute Act, Minimum Wages Act, Factories Act, Maternity Benefits Act, Payment of the Bonus Act, then Payment of Gratuity Act, then labor laws for like all the companies wherever women are in the formal sector, they have to comply with the labor protective labor legislations, Employees Provident Fund, Employee State Insurance, Collective Bargaining, Unorganized Sector Workers Act in 2009, Prevention of Sexual Harassment Act. All these acts, they get implemented when women are in the organized sector. But the unorganized sector, and the only 6% of women are in the organized sector who are protected by the labor legislation. And there are some regulations that are happening, but still, like we have seen Me Too movement, that even in the organized sector, there is a lot of other things, like if you want to show a woman her place, like you would use that weapon of sexual harassment. Or we have seen that Equal Remuneration Act in 1976, India adopted it when India signed the UN Charter on Equality, Development and Peace in 1975. As a result, we got the Equal Remuneration Act. Even in the directive principles of the Constitution of India, there was a guideline to pay the equal wages for equal work. Saman kaam ke liye, saman vetan. But implementation is a major problem. Even people in the organized sector, whether they are in the multinational companies, transnational companies, the first case which was filed, public interest litigation of implementation of the Equal Pay for Equal Work, Equal Remuneration Act, was by the employee of multinational company. We have seen even in the public sector, when it comes to promotion, when it comes to this thing, women face discrimination. There are various ways in which system tries to subvert it, either psychological pressure, emotional pressure, bringing out some this thing or harassment, sexual harassment. So we see that even when this 6% of women who are in the workforce, they are allowed to go up from little bit, little up. Because when I joined the workforce 45 years back, women never even aspire. They joined for one position, they would retire in some position. It was only during the 70s with the women's movement and all, women started even aspiring that we are competent, we are putting in efficiency plus, we have never given any excuse of being a woman and shirked any responsibility. We don't even take break for smoking, or we don't even report to work in an alcoholic condition, okay? And still, why aren't we getting this? So women started demanding the equal treatment and equal rewards for the work that is this. And what they first faced was a backlash of Whisper campaign and this. So we see that in organized sector, there are protective labor legislation, but they are also grossly violated. And the patriarchal, the camaraderie, the old boys club also sees to it that women don't get all the benefits of this thing. Even we have seen, even in the IT sector, all the studies are showing that women can go only up to junior manager level. Beyond that, they are not taken. Now, coming to the informal sector, 94% of the workforce, according to ILO, and as per the latest labor force participation rate data, which created a massive controversy, NSS data, of the government of India, nearly 13% of women are in the organized sector, 87 are in unorganized sector. Now, these unorganized sector, women in unorganized sector, they don't get any benefits of these 44 labor legislations. The prevention of sexual harassment at workplace, in theory, says that it covers both a formal and informal sector. But when we see in practice, informal sector workers immediately get witch hunted. Even in fact, women workers or young women workers of garment industry in Bangalore, they came out, they addressed public meetings about the Me Too. And all the employers, they just got united and they said that they started witch hunting, that no one should give them employment to this work. We have seen that now you don't even need a cruel employer. Now you have a state governments who are acting as employer. Because in the special economic zones, you read the study by Padmini Swaminathan of special economic zones in Tirupur, where the women textile workers, young unmarried women textile workers, they have to sign a bond to work in the SEZ, and it is a dormitory based production. That means you are not living with your family, you are living in the dorm, which they replicated the model which they had in China. Okay, so China, under the very dictatorial regime, they did it. But imagine in India, where you have a democratic governance, these girls are working as a bonded labor. And if they feel homesick, or if they want to go back, or if they are not able to maintain the production target, which are very heavy, because it is export oriented production, then they lose out everything. Okay. Similarly, you have a Sabla scheme for adolescent girls in Haryana. Okay, so even when the government violates all the labor laws, because in the SEZ, free trade zone, special economic zone, none of the protective labor laws are applicable in the name of attracting foreign direct investment and in the name of industrialization. No? So that is a problem. So informal sector workers, now we have at the shop floor level, a lot of unionization has taken place. Self-employed women's organization, SEWA, that is one such body which came up in the 70s when the textile mills were closing doors for women workers, because they were undergoing mechanization, automation and rationalization, and self-employed women's union came into existence. We see that at the shop floor level, young women, they are getting organized, they are fighting at this thing, but they don't have any legislative protection. So a lot of witch hunting they have to face, including the character assassination, because the kind of employers would ring up their husband, they would ring up their father, they would ring up their fiance, that what kind of woman you have, she's so quarrelsome at the factory, what kind of family she's going to. So many marriages are broken, so many their engagements have been broken. So this kind of a feudal forces are also being used against women who raise voice against any kind of exploitative, and it's a very, so there are no labor standards. If you are told to work for 12 hours, you have to work for 12 hours. If the production targets have to be met for the any global contract, then they have to work around the clock. And the only way they can protest is by fainting or by just saying that there is some ghost, bhoot aa gaya hai, and then they start. And this is not only in India, in Sri Lanka, Philippines, Indonesia, Thailand, no democratic expression to the women in free trade zone was allowed. So they would use only this kind of a subversive technique of getting possessed and saying that there is some ghost in the factory and we just can't work. No? So that
is unbelievable. I mean, I don't think the situation has improved even in 2020, because I remember when I had been to an interview, I was asked, in how many years are you planning to get married? And that will change their decision, or that will be the main focus of their decision and not my skill or my knowledge. So
in the 70s, any woman gave her wedding card, what she got in return was a termination order. In fact, in the city of Mumbai in 1972, 10,000 women working white collar jobs they were doing, they had a big rally in Mumbai in a fountain area. We want husband, we want job. That was the thing. We have seen it when I was in my college. So those were the days. Even in Air India, which was a government public sector enterprise directly under the government of India, there also air hostess had to forcibly retire at the age of 35, because even the Prime Minister Indira Gandhi thought that after 35 women lose their attractiveness. So this kind of male biases. They had, and then air hostesses got united, they formed their own union, and they said that equal remuneration, they also used Equal Remuneration Act 1976 has been used extensively by women in various public sector enterprises to get equal treatment.
So since you mentioned so many laws that are there to protect women workers in formal sector, what do you think, to what extent have they helped?
See, they have raised the bar, one can say that. So the kind of condition you had in the 70s, or my previous generation had to face, no? That as compared to that, you see, there is, because you have if you have a backing of your union, or if you have a women's organization, if you are able to knock at the door of courts, lower courts or labor courts or high courts or Supreme Court, and you, and there are so many human rights organizations, they also file public interest litigation for implementation of the law. So it is very important to have this protective labor legislation. There may be violation, like the traffic laws are also violated. For that, we never say that there should not be signal system. Okay. So then, so I think laws are, protective legislations are very important. Moreover, India is also signatory to all the global instruments, whether it is a UDHR or the three generations of human rights, social, and also CEDAW, Convention on Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women. India is signatory to CEDAW. India is the signatory to Platform for Action in 1995, no, the Beijing Congress. India is signatory to Nairobi Forward-Looking Strategy, which talks about and the World Economic Forum. There are only three countries where you have such inhuman work condition for women in the labor market, and labor markets are not the way mainstream economics talks about labor market. There are no free forces of market. All labor markets are socially constructed. There is intersectionality of caste, class, race, religion, ethnicity, gender, location, and which language you speak. So in this context, affirmative action becomes extremely important because of the historical injustices that women have faced. Okay, that is how. So I think it's a very important, because patriarchal value system controls women's fertility. It controls women's sexuality, and it also controls women's labor. So I think that, to challenge that, I think the protective labor laws are extremely important. And currently what we see, that these new labor codes, which have compressed 44 labor laws into 4 laws, none of them even mention women. For them, women just don't exist, whether it's a law on wages. What is how do they calculate wages? Well, the definition they have given is 2700 calorie of per day the household should get. What should be they consider as a 3 consumption units. Who is a 3 consumption unit? Husband, wife, and 2 children. So 2 children is equal to 1 consumption unit. Imagine if you have an adult son and adult 15-year-old daughter or 13-year-old son. They are going to eat as much as the adults do. They are growing children, okay? And plus, most of the working class, the recent studies by all the trade union is showing that because of galloping inflation and also under this kind of a pandemic, so many elderly people who were earlier separated, now they are also dependent on that. They have come back. They are staying with their extended family. So it is unrealistic definition of a family as a 3 consumption unit. You need a minimum 5 to 6 consumption units. And they say 66 yard of cloth per household. Can you imagine 66 yard? How can a whole household can be clothed? Or 10% of expenditure on food and clothing is equal to housing. Urban housing is so expensive. Minimum, even if you want to be in the slum, 55,000 per month you have to pay. In the dirtiest slum you have to pay. So it's a completely unrealistic way of even defining minimum wage. And in that, woman is just not there. She's just, man is a breadwinner. That is the only message that comes out. There is nothing about the reproductive health issues of women. When you have a 23, currently according to government data, there are 23% NSSO data, 23% of women are in the workforce. Even their reproductive health needs, their menstrual needs, if they are pregnant, they're labored, if they're lactating mothers, nothing they have mentioned about it. Sexual harassment at workplace, so many reported cases are there in the National Crimes Record Bureau. Me Too movement has, in the last 3 years, has brought out the whole muck of the militant patriarchy and the toxic patriarchy that is working at the workplace. But there is no mention about that in the labor codes. So you can see there is a complete misogyny and also gender blindness, you can say, if you say that, okay, they need it unconsciously, okay, even if you want to grant them that, then there is a complete gender insensitivity about the women in the workforce in this labor codes.
Thank you, ma'am. So since you mentioned reproductive health, would you say sanitation of women or the workers have improved as of 2020?
To some extent, in terms of public awareness, earlier nobody would even talk about it. They would talk in a hush-hush tone. They would talk in a very derogatory way. Now, women, also the younger generation of women, we say whether it's a working class or middle class or a school-going girl or working in the factory, that sense of shame about menstruation, that is slowly and gradually going on. Otherwise, we have a organization of adolescent girls in municipal school and all, the way women would be teased. In fact, many of them would not come. And right from teacher to boys in the class also would, she must be menstruating, no? That way, and they would all giggle and all. So all that is now gone. Another thing is that use of sanitary pads, I think the campaign over last three, four years, we see that because of the efforts of the non-government organization, civil society organization, lot of media coverage and the CSR activities which various people have taken over. Bollywood has also taken up this theme. There are a lot of documentaries, organization, mass-based organization and community-based organization like ActionAid, Sri Mukti Sangatha, all of them have been taking up this issue, talking about it in public. So I think that stigma attached to menstruation, it's not there. At other level, we have also seen that whole Shabrimala controversy or a controversy about Shani Shingno temple, entry in the Shani Shingno temple, or Muslim women, Bamma Bhatiya Muslim Mahila Andolan, they are filing case in the High Court in about entry into the Haji Ali Dargah. Okay, so all these issues also, the discourse revolved around purity and pollution. And also Baba Saheb, the Dalit movement has also been very articulate. Baba Saheb writings that has generated massive interest among the youth in India, where he talks about the purity and pollution. He says that the Dalit and women are the same because those 5 days of their life, that means 1/6 of the life, women are also untouchable. And there are so many communities and tribes, whether they are tribals in Chandrapur district or a Gondia tribe or a women in Nepal, where the menstrual taboos are so strong and they are isolated and they have been attacked by, because in the tribal villages, the menstruating girl has to live separately in a mud hut, even in the winter, in a monsoon. So many of them were bitten by snake. There have been cases of rape because now the tribal hamlets are not isolated. There are national highways and state highways going there, people knowing that this the single girl and they were being attacked. So a lot of documentation and campaigning has taken place. Another thing is that women in health movement, people science, Janaswasthya Abhiyan, Medico Friends Circle, these are the organizations, they have also articulated. So there is a professionals, medical professionals, nursing community, and the citizens. They have taken up this issue very seriously. Anganwadi workers, ASHA workers, they are also providing the counseling facilities. So things are changing. The whole taboo about menstruation is going away. Even the use of sanitary pad. One student who is currently doing, Sohail Akhtar, he is doing relief work in Bihar and the areas in which in Simanchal. And he says that when he went there with the sanitary pads, all of them just got scared. Finally, he took the elderly women from Gram Sabha and asked them to distribute sanitary pads. And it's because in India, if you see that 85% of women have reproductive tract infection, white discharge, foul-smelling discharge, and it is also linked to so many other pregnancy-related problems also. If you have an infection and if you have pregnancy, there are a lot of chances of miscarriages, stillborn babies, neonatal problems and all. So from the health point of view, so health movement, women's movement, and also the Panchayati Raj institution, because the areas in which you have everywhere there are 33% women elected representatives over last 30 years since 1994 till the day. 16 states have 50% women who are in the Panchayati Raj institution because they are in a considerable strength, because it's a critical minimum. They now one or two women can be counted out. But if you have 33% or 50% women who are talking about this issue in public, it is difficult to witch hunt. Okay? So we can see that all these forces have created a situation where there is a readiness to accept discussion, public discourse on menstrual hygiene.
So according to the new labor law announcement, there are a lot of dilutions. In fact, the labor laws are diluted. So how do you think that will affect women's access to sanitation at workplace?
Yeah, so I think the first thing is that our touchstone should be the ILO's convention. ILO completed its 100 years, the centenary year was 2019, and it talked about the decent work. And India is signatory to ILO convention on decent work. And I quote that, what ILO says, that the decent work is a respect that fundamental right of the human person, as well as rights of workers in terms of workplace safety and remuneration, respect for physical and mental integrity of workers in the exercise of his or her employment. So I think both informal and informal sector, that's what ILO talks about. But what we see that these four labor codes, they are going to affect all the workers, and especially women will have a double whammy because of the patriarchal bias also, that in terms of good opportunities in the workforce, because now we are talking about Stand Up India and Startup India and Make in India and artificial intelligence and future of work and machine learning and all that, women are deprived because though we have a 300 state-of-the-art industrial training institutes, which provide more than 200 courses, all these institutes are providing only two skills to women, tailoring and screen printing. First of all, screen printing is now in 2 days, it has become redundant. People are just taking direct printout. And second one is tailoring, which is not competitive. Everywhere, every nook and corner, you have tailors. Okay, so women are losing out in terms of opportunities. Their income is affected because this labor code don't even talk about the equal wages. ERA has been gone, Equal Remuneration Act. The security of work, because now, as in the previous lecture, Mimamsa extensively gave the data about how states after states, like around 12 states, have already abandoned the labor laws, even the labor standard, which ILO talks about 8 hours of work, 8 hours of leisure, and 8 hours of sleep, leisure and recreation, and 8 hours of rest. Now, that formula is gone. It took 200 years for the working class movement. How did International Women's Day came? It was on 8th March in 1910 that women workers in Chicago asked for 8 hours of work. They were made to work for 16 hours. They asked for the humane work condition, and they asked for childcare facilities for children, for their children. All these things, there is such a long collective endeavor that the women's movement has made, and the working class women have shown their solidarity and strength and collective spirit. All that is being wiped out, and we are turning the wheels of history in a backward direction. So that is one. Plus security doesn't talk about what safety and security at workplace. There is nothing in the labor code. There is nothing about the social protection. On the contrary, the formula of minimum wages is going to wipe out whatever, like 16 states have more minimum wages than what this labor code are talking about. Already they are there. Okay, so in Kerala, like it was 600 rupees plus it starts from say minimum 143 to 1100. Okay, so if you are a skilled worker, you get 1100. These labor codes divide the workforce into unskilled, semi-skilled, skilled, and highly skilled. Okay, now how are you going to judge that? There are no indicators, no clarity, nowhere you can see. Everything is left ambiguous, and it would be the interpretation of the bureaucrat in the labor department to decide, no, in the state level. So that is there. Plus, what kind of better prospects women will get when there are 94% of them are in the informal sector, and when the labor markets are so discriminatory when it comes to women, there is a segmentation in the labor market. And also it's going to take away freedom of expression, that the unionization, or even in the any new units, startups and the new units which are emerging in the post-COVID era, you can't have strikes. Some states are saying for 3 years you can't you can't have any trade union, or you can't go on a strike. Even if the workers are currently, even when the laws are there, we are seeing so many cases of gross violation of workers. The workplace violence is extremely high. And now when you take away all these laws, it's going to create complete barbarism. It's going to create a new system of a bonded labor or slavery. So, and that's why I think the women's organizations have this thing. Plus, it doesn't even cover some of the very important service, like majority. So many lakhs of women are in the domestic work. And All India Domestic Workers Union has also shared that it's just that the labor code has nothing to say about the domestic workers. They are not even included. Okay, those who are providing services, they are not even included. What about the gig economy? What about the platform-based work? In fact, so many, like all these Urban Clap and all the various platform-based services, they are providing 120 types of services. What's going to happen to these women? You need to have some kind of a labor protective legislations for them, but labor code doesn't even talk. It's completely silent about it. And that's why in Indian Association for Women's Studies also, we passed resolution about the labor code, because already one labor code had been passed by the Parliament of India, and the second one was one on the industrial relations was with the Parliamentary Cabinet Committee. And three bills, the total three bills and the one act were already there. So here we said that our on the resolution about the because what Indian Association for Women's Studies, which is an organization existing since 1981, and there are members are 144 women's studies centers in the university system of our country. And there are women activists, women's organizations, independent researchers, ICSSR centers, all of them are members of this organization. And we unanimously passed that the government should ratify ILO Convention 189. In line with this, domestic workers need to be recognized as workers and brought into the ambit of statutory law like Industrial Dispute Act. They should be allowed to form and register their union without hindrance from the registrar of the trade union. And the nature of the paid informal work has to be radically transformed by exploring the possibility of municipalizing such work, because the local ward can keep a tab. Like see in Kerala, the Seva Kerala, they are the domestic workers in Trivandrum city or in Kerala, they are unionized. Their salary directly, the account is maintained by Seva, that salary is directly credited to their account. And that's why the non-payment of wages, sometimes you see the recent study by Indian Social Studies Trust, in last 4 months, 85% of domestic workers have not received their wages from March, because the lockdown was declared on 25th of March. They are making phone calls, the mobile there, the employers are not picking them up. They are not giving. So this kind of situation will not happen if we have that the local municipal body keeps the registry of domestic workers, they can intervene. So there is this demand of the women's studies and women's movement. Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am. So that's a huge number. I mean, even after running campaigns and even after educating people how important it is to pay your domestic help, we still see such a high percentage of women that were not paid during this crisis.
Yeah.
So that's really shocking. So I'll move on.
Yeah.
So since there are so many labor laws in place, and it's to some extent helping women and their rights, what according to you should be changed or should be proposed from a development perspective to make the workplace more women friendly?
I think we should, our touchstone should be Constitution of India, Article 14, 15, 16, that should be this thing, directive principles, where the social security and social protection, affirmative actions are demanded. And we currently, we have 200 laws. Each state, according to their condition, whether they have an agrarian sector is more important, forest-based economy is more prominent, or the manufacturing sector is more prominent. So accordingly, different states have a specific laws to govern the labor market. Okay, so they are there. So I think respect for that. is because there is a specificity. Just four labor codes can't handle the such a complex reality and the variety of life situations and the industrial relations which are existing. In certain areas, you have bonded labor systems. Certain areas, you have a tenant-based production. Sometimes, certain places, you have a sharecropping. Certain places, you have a wage-labor contract system. So, right from the colonial times, we have seen that the labor markets are in a very, very different kind of a situation. So I think we need a specific, that specific reality has to be, we have to be sensitive to that and see how we can empower women. Other thing is that mobilization of women, that human rights organizations, trade unions, and the civil society organizations, they have to come together to talk, to verbalize the concerns of and visibilize the concerns of workers. For the first time, at least, we talked about migrant workers as a human beings. Okay, otherwise, in the earlier discourse, whether it was by media or by community, local people, it was always like they were seen as a burden on the local economy. Anything went wrong in the local economy, migrant workers were blamed. It was Anand Patwardhan's film, Bombay Hamara Shahar, which gave the whole contribution that the migrants are making. All the studies which have come up in last 4 months are also showing that how 65% of the country's production is responsible directly from the migrant workers, okay? There are 12 crore migrant workers, out of which 3 crore are women. Okay, men, lot of women, they say 85% of women migrate due to marriage. But even after marriage, when they go to in-laws' family, they are working. No, they are not only wife, they are also working. Okay, they may be working in an informal sector or home-based work or formal sector. So when we say that women migrate due to marriage, it doesn't mean that they are homebound. They are constantly contributing to the so this myth about among the demographers that women migrate for marriage and men migrate for work, that is not there. That we have to change our mindset, and that has happened because we saw this time. So the question of migrant workers, and also we started even talking about the affordable rent for the migrant workers, in which the state has to take responsibility. If you leave it to the private sector, the same tragic scenario will repeat, because if they are not able to pay the rent, then they will be thrown out by the private construction lobby or by the private landlords. Okay, so we have to come up with a policy level, evidence based, because now there are a lot of evidences have been created by the rapid need assessment studies done by the NGOs, by the self-help groups, by the women's organization, women's studies center, and trade unions. I think we should take this collective wisdom and come up with the macro policies which are humane, which are providing social security, social protection, and fair wages to the and decent work situation to the workers. And we also need to do more and more public education. Like we got in 2009, we got a social security, act, unorganized sector, social security act, we got in 2009. How much publicity is there about it? How many FM radios or Doordarshan programs are there on this issue? How many public education advertisements are there about this act? This is the first time informal sector workers the act provides for social security of informal sectors. And there is no, an informal sector also, 60% of the informal workers are women who are managing their home with 20 rupees per day. So you can imagine what is the kind of situation in which these women workers are working in informal sector. So I think more public awareness is also very important. And in the Indian Association of Women's Studies, we gave a very comprehensive critique of all the four labor codes. About and pass the resolution after a lot of deliberation, taking care of all these aspects. Yeah.
All right. So I know you have written many papers, and one of them is on gender-responsive budgeting. So what is gender-responsive budgeting? And do you think that making menstrual hygiene management a central part of it will help us?
Yeah, so see, the current gender responsive budgeting is not a separate budget. It is a budget seeing the budget with the gender lens, that which are the budgetary provisions which are creating enabling environment for women and enabling ecosystem for women, and which are the provisions which are going to create more disabling disabling environment for women. So coming up with using taxpayers' money in such a way that women, the gender gap in this economy, whether it is in terms of economic opportunity, because women, you as I say, that only 23% are women in the workforce. Within the workforce also, they are at the lowest bottom of the economic pyramid. Okay, so economic opportunity. Then this the education, the gender gap in education, because we see that the high dropout rate among women in the secondary school, in the college level, by when they reach the university, there are only 15% of women in the total women in that age group in the university system. And even when they fare very good, well, in the education, the system is, the condition is such that even 40% of women with degree in MBA, they give up their job after marriage or maternity. Okay, so that comes to this thing. So the third one is in the political participation. What kind of voice women have in the political participation? Is your budget empowering them, giving them more confidence to enter into public life? That is also there. In terms of health, why do we have one of the highest maternal mortality, child mortality, and maternal morbidity in our country? Why 85% of Indian women still have anemia? Okay, and anemia is a major killer for Indian women. Iron deficiency anemia, calcium deficiency. So that means health intervention. Is our public health system currently also only 56% of women are getting their delivery or antenatal care by the qualified medical practitioner? All others have to depend on the back door. So these are some of the very important intervention which through budget you can make up. When we do the dissection of our budget, why do we see that whole reproductive child health budget? Whenever it comes to gender budgeting, lion's share is on reproductive and child health. And that reproductive and child health touches only women in the age group of 15 to 49 who are supposed to be producing babies. And that too, not with the perspective of improving their health, but only for population control. So you have a most sophisticated this thing of a contraception and sterilization and laparoscopic sterilization camp for sterilization. And currently we have 16 states which are below population stabilization. That means couples are producing less than 2 children. So major portion of the budget goes only in the population control. But what about the women nutrition? Dealing with their anemia, giving them antenatal care, giving them postpartum care, giving them creating a midday meal scheme. Like some states have a very good record. For example, Tamil Nadu has the best midday meal scheme. Why can't it be replicated in all other states? ICDS, ICDS budget, why can't we increase? So fighting for these five needs, health, education, economic opportunity, political participation, and also defense, creating a safe environment, crimes against women, violence against women and girls, you have to fight against that. Now you are going beyond gender binary. When we talk about the gender responsive budget, we are not only talking about men and women, boys and girls, we are talking of the transgender budget. So only in Tamil Nadu, Kerala, we have a special component for the transgender community, because they are the ones who get abandoned by their own biological families. They are the ones who are forced to do the begging in the public place and also work through sex. They are forced into sex work. So isn't it the duty of the state to ensure their opportunity, right to education, right to dignified life, and right to housing, because they are homeless. So that is there. In so Chhattisgarh is the one state where the transgender community say that they want separate toilet. They say that if we use women's toilet, women get scared. And if we will not use men's toilet, because we will be raped, because so many of them get raped. So they said, we want a separate toilet. And Chhattisgarh government agreed. And that came as a part of a gender budgeting. So how you see the gender-based relations in our society, which are continuously changing, and accordingly your demands have to be changed, because gender budgeting as a concept came into existence because of the demands of the young women in Australia. Because they say in the industrialized world, at the age of 15, your parents ask you to be independent. It's a different story for a boy at the age of 15. But when a 15-year-old girl is away from her family, she faces a lot of trouble. She can't sleep on the platform, or the person who helps her may take her advantage. The teenage pregnancy is extremely high. And it is in this context that the youth movement of Australia asked for from the state that how are you using, nobody is parasite in the economy. Everybody is a contributor because all of us are paying indirect tax. Even if you buy pound vada from station, tax you are paying. So just don't say that for one particular segment is a parasite or a sponge on the economy. Nobody is a sponge. Everyone has a right to ask that what are you doing with our taxpayers' money? So that is the kind of a social accountability, transparency for gender justice, distributive justice, and social justice that gender responsive budget asks for.
So there is this notion in the middle class people, whenever something is happening, what are they doing with my taxpayer money? But they don't consider that your contribution is nothing as compared to a person who's contributing from the below poverty line.
Yeah, and plus unpaid work. The moment you talk about unpaid work, all the poor people, because there is a wage theft. When you pay naka worker, when you pay informal worker, less than minimum wages, it is nothing but a theft. Gandhiji also said, no? Gandhiji also said, it's a theft. So you have done the wage theft by not paying wages to your domestic worker or paying her less than the minimum wages of the state to your domestic worker. So in fact, you are guilty. Middle class is guilty of wage theft rather than telling that poor person as a parasite.
So with all the underlying conditions and problems that are in existence in our country, I think we can draw a conclusion that dilution of labor laws will be very disastrous, will affect menstruators, will affect women and also men. So I think this is something, the part where menstruators are getting affected is less spoken. And I think you have very well addressed to that topic. And I think our viewers also will thank you for that. And from my side, I think it was a wonderful session covering economics, covering women's contribution and how dilution of labor law will affect menstruators the most. I think it was the end. I'll check if there's any question.
Or can I also read the resolution on labor code by the, okay, we unanimously around, there were 800 delegates in the Indian Association for Women's Studies, and our resolution on labor code goes like that Indian Association for Women's Studies expresses deep concern at the manner in which rights of workers and women workers in particular are being subverted by four labor codes that are simultaneously repealing 44 labor laws. The enacted code on wage effectively excludes domestic workers and home-based workers from coverage by not including private households in the definition of establishment with employees, workers, and reversing the advances made by the domestic workers who had achieved inclusion in the schedule of employment covered by Minimum Wages Act 1948 in several states. So whatever they had gained is also being wiped out. Similarly, depriving home workers in a BD of BD workers in a minimum wages and time, because they also roll BD at home and they had access to under the law, under the BD Workers Act. The non-inclusion of the stipulation that wages of interstate migration, that's very, very important, should not be lower than the prevailing rates of the local workers. So migrant workers can't be paid less than the local workers. So that was also there. That also goes away with the labor codes. It is universally accepted that legal entitlements of workers, particularly with regard to minimum wages and equal remuneration, are flouted by majority of employers, including the government, because in NREGA also we see that they are not paid equal wages. IWS holds that it is an unacceptably regressive step for the definition of normal working day to be stretched to 12 hours. Okay, so that also we are opposing. IWS is deeply concerned about the Code of Occupational Safety, Health and Working Condition Bill, which is currently in the Parliament. introduced in the past had not included prevention of sexual harassment as a matter of the safety, health and working condition. Then while welcoming the inclusion of code on social security bill, which is there, but we can see that there is absence of adequate conception of minimum standard of social security. There is no clarity about what we mean by social security. And IIWS also condemns backdoor insertion of fixed term employment. That means it is the moment your contract gets over, the employer has even if you have worked for 3 to 5 years, employer can just check you out, which is earlier it was not there. If you are working for 1 year, then without any substantial reason, they can't throw you out. And at a time when women workers have been asserting their place in the trade unions, the Code on Industrial Relations Bill is introducing impediment to unionization and provision that will make almost any strike illegal. IIWS strongly opposes such attempts to curtail trade union rights and illegalize the industrial action by the workers. And we saw just 3 days back, 5 lakh ASHA workers who are facing extremely inhuman condition. They are the corona warriors. They went on a strike. And finally, again, because of their collective strength, government had to come on the negotiation table. That means there is a strength in number. Women united will never be defeated.
So we have this policies. What about Maternity Benefits Act? How will that be affected?
Yeah. So we have a 2019 Maternity Benefit Act, which had increased the maternity benefits from 12 hours, which was earlier 1961 Act, which were 12 weeks to 26 weeks. But that was applicable only to the 6% of women in the only in the formal sector. So that it had a limitation, but currently also, like if we go by the 2009 law, Social Security and Social Protection Act for women, and ILO's convention talks about both formal and informal sector worker. And currently all the trade unions have made representation after the 7th July, when the 12 states decided to abandon the labor law. Immediately all the trade unions came together and they made representation to ILO. ILO intervened. And for the first time in last 4 months, we even realized that we had a labor minister. He gave interview in Indian Express and he says that no, they are not going to do away with the labor laws. So I think if we keep up our pressure, and if there is a continuously we need to hammer that workers' rights are human rights, that hammering will have to be done by not only them, but by the conscious citizens like us. So the solidarity is very important. And I think workers united will never be defeated.
That's actually something that we can take out of this session, that how important solidarity is, how important awareness is. I think that's the end. There's no question. Would you like to conclude by saying a few words?
Yeah. That whatever gender commitments and the rhetorics we are making, the platitudes with the political leaders and movers and shakers of the country and the policymakers are giving so many gender promises, but in when it comes to implementation, nothing is happening. So I think we need to see to, like we have to build the pressure to see to it that, first of all, whatever are the historical gains of the working class movement, they are not wiped out. That means our labor laws, they remain. And secondly, that we have to create a global pressure, because I think under the cloak of corona and under the guise of coronavirus, so many countries are abandoning the democratic rights of the working class. So I think that global solidarity, national level solidarity, and the local level solidarity is the only answer that we have against this kind of draconian measures that are imposed by the state.
So this final question, I promise this is the final one. As a viewer, as a common citizen, as a woman, how can I contribute to the betterment? How can I contribute the solidarity? How can I cooperate with the...
So I think in the personal life, like we, first of all, seeing workers as human beings, as citizens with their entitlement, that would be one major paradigm shift we need to have. because the gated community is a very, very different kind of a look. But I think we saw during the last 4 months also, in so many places, there was a solidarity there, like whether they were watchmen or driver or people, poor people in the area, people were cooking food and giving and all. So things are a bit changing. And the younger generation, I found far more sensitive than my generation. So that is the one starting from beginning, like setting an example of a human person to person level, the people to people level solidarity in your personal, as a individual, in the community, in your neighborhood. That is one. Secondly, the currently, because of the insecurity and people are becoming more and more inward looking. So I think fighting with yourself to reach out to fellow human beings, that would be one. Secondly, wherever there are anti-working class statements being made, whether it is in a public platform or in a media, at least you have to stick out your neck. You just can't behave that it is just a very light issue or whether it is a very marginal issue. No, it is not. That means that the kind of seriousness with which we are talking just now, I think the same thing has to happen in our discourses, public discourses that is there. Currently, there are a lot of educational material, documentaries on the issues of the working class solidarity about this issue. So I think taking it to any public platform, whether it is and seeing to it that the media takes up this issue, because there was a time like when I was HOD of Economics Department, my students would say, "Ma'am, we remove labor studies." So much pressure from students that, ma'am, we don't want labor studies. It's such a dry topic. Just have a financial economics, intellectual property and all that. No? So that was the time. I'm talking of immediately after new economic policy, 91 and all. So I think we should see that even there is the issue has to be alive. The way we talk about climate change, the way we talk about environmental education, the way we talk about the secular ethos, okay? Same way, I think the workers' rights, we have to talk about that. We and all the historical injustices that has happened in the past, we should discuss. If you are a literature person from literature, you can discuss Premchandra's G's Hindi novel, or you can discuss some poetry. So sensitizing the people to change their mindset, to change their behavior, I think is very, very important. And also those who have a power, those who are in the power, who are in the industry, who are in politics, who are in a public life, I think changing their mindset is also very important. So at one level, we need a law and penalize those who are violating the labor laws, and also at the other level, changing the people. And I think even in the syllabus, even in the schools, in the debates, discussion, public discourses, everywhere, I think we should bring the issue. The way we saw in last 4 months, there are so many expressions about the migrant worker. There are paintings and stories and verses, and like there is an organization called Swati. Every day they take one case of an informal sector migrant worker and they weave a story around her. It's extremely sensitive. So I think sensitization of the people about these issues is very important. And wherever we have power, we should use our power to be judicious in and strengthening the weak.
I think way forward, we privileged ones can use our power, our privilege to sensitize and contribute to the betterment of the informal sector of people. I think we can conclude this session. It was an honor to listen to you. Your abundance of knowledge will definitely help us, will help us help the community. Thank you.
Thank you for the opportunity. And I feel really good to interact because I'm 65, you may be in your mid-20s, and then still we click with each other. That's quite empowering for me too, that we have not become dinosaurs. We are still relevant. Yeah.
I feel like you are very important. Your years of experience are helping us improve. So that's really a good opportunity for us.
So humble. Yeah. Thank you.
I think we're like
touched by your humility. Thank you. Thank you. Really, it was very, very, I also thoroughly enjoyed this conversation.